Good evening, everyone. My task is to welcome you here and tell you how pleased we are to have you. I have that task because I was told I was a senior member of the Chambers. I think the truth is I was simply the oldest available. And that's why I'm introducing the topic and Natasha and Derek. The topic comes out of now a series of presentations done by Derek and Natasha in relation to family law matters, where Thorne and Kennedy was one half of each of those provisions. Derek, for your information, is a practitioner now of 12 years experience, nine of those as counsel. He says he spent 1 year being a solicitor. That may overstate it, because I know from our own personal relationship that most of that was spent on secondment somewhere else, and he didn't want to turn up at Three Hills at all. And when they said come back, he said, I'm going to the bar. Natasha has been a solicitor, a practitioner since 2001, spent 11 of those years as a solicitor, in a fairly knockabout way, practising in Western Australia and Darwin, at the Australian Human Rights Commission, at Land Rights Councils, and then more recently at the Bar in Public Law. Both of them have developed an interest in family law, which is why we're presenting this seminar this afternoon. Having sat through these presentations, I can say to you that you all probably noticed, and I was asked this evening before we started, whether the decision would put family law practitioners out of business. That was a common reaction in the press, that the decision was the end of effective binding financial agreements. I really don't understand why. I certainly think that is not the case. And the main reason for that is that the High Court didn't set aside these agreements because they were unfair. Indeed, they were described in the evidence of Ms. Thorne's independent solicitor as the worst agreement she'd ever seen in her 12 years or so of practice. They even noticed that Ms. Thorne clearly understood that was her independent solicitor's advice. That is not why they set the agreements aside. Why they set it aside is they asked themselves the question, and it's a question that they commended the primary judge for herself addressing: why would anyone sign the worst agreement that the independent solicitor had ever seen? And it's the question as to why that the seminar is addressed. It was the answer to the question why that was the basis of the setting aside of the agreements. They were not set aside because of their gross unfairness to Ms. Thorne. The point of that is, as you will see in the chronology, if it had been done differently, a little earlier, and before, earlier than 4 days before the marriage, the agreements might well have survived. The way the presentation will go, Derek will give you a short outline of the common features to the majority judgments and the concurring but disagreeing judgments of Justice Nettle and Gordon. He'll then address Natasha will then address the majority judgments, and Derek the two minority judgments. Thank you.
The press coverage of Thorne and Kennedy has been quite remarkable, actually. It's almost alarming. in fact, how it's been treated in the mainstream press, I think it's fair to say that from the discussions we've had in this chambers, that the decision's in fact not that controversial. It provides some useful guidance in the Family Law Act, the particular statutory regime within which the family law matters are determined. It provides some useful guidance in that area, but realistically, I don't think it takes necessarily the law relating to undue influence or unconscionable conduct very much further than the already existing case law and jurisprudence in this area. What I propose to do is I'm just going to very briefly recap on the Amadio-type principles in equity, and then Natasha is going to spend some time on the majority judgment, and then I'm going to come back and talk to you a little bit about the two judgments of Justice Nettle and Gordon, in particular what Justice Nettle had to say about duress and what Justice Gordon had to say about undue influence and why it was that Her Honour found that it was in fact unconscionable conduct rather than undue influence, or be the basis for the setting aside of the financial agreements. To recap, I think in fact the provision, we merged together some slides earlier, so just ignore the subsection reference, but other than that, the Act provides that financial agreements before relationships, during, or even after relationships may be set aside on the basis that they were voidable and unenforceable. And that brings into play, therefore, the principles of duress and, within equity, the principles of undue influence and unconscionable conduct. Now, duress, of course, in the modern context, primarily a common law theory, and is concerned with unlawful pressure, the classic example being the gun to the head. I think I've told this joke to you before, but I'm going to tell you again because it entertains me at least. I had a client come here to Chambers who wanted advice on the setting aside of a loan agreement, a mortgage. And he said, I only entered that agreement under duress. I said, what exactly was the duress? And he said, the situation was this. They sat me down and they said to me, unless you sign that, we won't give you the money. I had to explain to him that might not get over the line, but I could see where he was taking it, but didn't go anywhere. Equity, on the other hand, is concerned with lawful conduct, but that is unconscionable. And that is typically where there has been undue influence or unconscionable conduct. Equity, in the most general sense, is fairness in the resolution of disputes, and it fastens on the conscience of the parties. What is the right? What is the equitable thing to do? What is the right thing to do according to the principles of equity? And in the family law context, why not refer to Spry? After all, Spry has observed that its principles have a distinctive ethical quality, reflecting as they do the prevention of unconscionable conduct. And as Terence Lynch has said to me many times in fact 13 years I've been at the bar, he's in fact very good on accounting cases, but adding up is not so good. As Terence has said to me time and again, he said, look, you've got to understand with equity. He said, there are always rules, and they're easily understood, and then there are exceptions, and those exceptions are informed by ethics. And so in the classic illustration of the undue influence and unconscionable conduct that we're going to discuss today, we have the starting point of the Commonwealth Bank and Amadio, and you recall that in that case, the bank was effectively in cahoots with the son of these migrant parents, and the parents signed a loan agreement and a guarantee, and ultimately the agreements were set aside by application of equitable principles. But importantly, the decision of His Honour Justice Dean, where he recognised that whilst the notions of unconscionable dealing and undue undue influence are closely related. They are, however, importantly distinct. Now, this very succinct statement is, in fact, the subject matter of a great deal of the decision in Thorne and Kennedy. There's a great many, very many words are spent on further explaining these principles. And really, I think it's fair to say, Natasha, the justices argue or build a lot from the principles in Vanadio. So let's take a moment to talk about, again, the two principles, undue influence, unconscionable conduct. In undue influence, the focus of inquiry is on the quality of the consent of the weaker party. Right? So you look to the quality of the consent. But keep in mind that very many factual scenarios that will give rise in your practice to this sort of inquiry. Am I dealing with undue influence? Am I dealing with unconscionable conduct? They in fact may give rise to, very readily give rise to, both on first impressions. The best analysis, however, is to consider that on the one hand we're going to look at quality of consent in undue influence, and then you look to improper conduct on unconscionable conduct. Quality of consent, a very simple proposition. Was the judgment impaired by, for example, coercion, pressure, or concealment? Did the influence prevent the weaker party from making an independent and informed judgment? So that's, in very simple terms, undue influence. Look to the quality of the consent. On the other side of the same coin is the question of unconscionable conduct. And that focus of inquiry is on the improper conduct of the stronger party. Is that person taking advantage of the special disadvantage of the weaker party? Now, special disadvantage may arise in any number of circumstances. There was a special disadvantage in Amadio by reason of the dynamic as between the son and the migrant parents and the bank and the migrant parents. But the relevant factors would include such matters as age, lack of education, or lack of assistance or explanation where such is necessary. In this case, the Thorne and Kennedy line of authorities were dealing with what's been called the ink on the wedding dress cases. That is where the financial agreement is entered into so close to or proximate to the wedding, the date of the wedding. That's an introduction to the principles that are at play: duress, undue influence, unconscionable conduct in the decision of Thorne and Kennedy. What I'll do now is hand over to Natasha to discuss with you the majority decision, and then I'll come back and talk to you about the two minority decisions.
Thanks, Terry. And thank you, Terry, for your kind introduction. I must say, for myself, I prefer the word peripatetic to knockabout. I think it sounds much posher. There are at least four things to recommend the decision of the High Court in Thorne and Kennedy to you. They are the fact that it is mercifully short. The second is that it is a whirlwind tour de force of the equitable grounds for setting aside improvident agreements. And thirdly, it tells you everything you need to know about section 90 capital K 1 little b and little e. It's also got some legal gossip in it, which adds to the fun factor. So in my view, this case is an almost complete toolbox for dealing with financial agreements or setting aside financial agreements. And you should therefore become familiar with it and pull it out at every opportunity. Now, one of the first things that the High Court says at paragraph 23 of the decision is that, or the majority says, and I should say also, the majority decision is very positivist. And one of the other fun aspects of the decision is that the minority decisions sound either more adventurous notes on the application of the principles or cautionary, more reserved notes. So while you can rely on the large majority decision, it's useful also to be familiar with the minority decisions because they don't exactly give you wriggle room, but they show that if the right case arises, there might be some space to bring that additional, a further case to the High Court. The fact that, the other fun fact to me is that in this case, you've got a family law decision leading the field on authorities on equitable principles, which I think must be a first. But returning to the first point that the majority makes, at paragraph 23, being engaged is not a ground for finding anything special about a relationship for the application of the equitable principles. At 23, the majority starts dealing with the principle of duress and its application under section 90K1A. Whilst for the nerds who may have read the High Court transcript on the special leave application, it might have appeared that duress was the main principle at play in this decision, and were eagerly awaiting the decision thinking, oh, we're going to have something brand new on duress and it's going to be very exciting. In fact, the majority says with, I would say, an air of disappointment, that in fact at the hearing there was nothing really advanced by Ms. Thorne on which anyone could say anything about duress. Now, that doesn't stop some of the minority judges, as Derek will expand upon, but that's just a point for the nerds. The majority does, in its roundup of these equitable principles of duress, undue influence and unconscionable conduct, spend a bit of time talking about distinguishing duress from the other grounds for setting aside. And duress is the scenario where you essentially have a gun to your head. So there's no question that you have consented to something that you think may be in your interests or without regard to your interests. It's something that you agree to knowing that it is against your interests, but which to which you consent in any event. Now, at paragraph 27, the High Court very succinctly states the state of the jurisprudence and, in my view, why the High Court was interested, perhaps, in hearing this case. And that is that in the old jurisprudence, it was required that the threat to the person be unlawful in nature and illegal in nature. But in a decision in 1976, Occidental Worldwide, that restriction was departed from. But more recently, the New South Wales Court of Appeal has decided in the decision of ANZ and Karam that in fact you do need illegality. And so the jurisprudence in Australia is all in a bit of a state of uncertainty. But I note that this is not the first time since Karam was decided that the High Court has, I think in 2013, avoided the question. But it appears that in this case they were eager to deal with it but then found that they could not. Now, perhaps that eagerness is reflected in the fact that despite the fact that the court was unable to deal with it, it does spend some time talking about the state of the jurisprudence and highlighting where it may be and how it may be that the issue may arise again, and perhaps, or certainly without indicating where they might go with it, but that they are eager to consider the issue again. And in particular, at paragraph 29, that this may have, there may be some special significance arising from the family law context in cases of duress. Turning to the principle of undue influence, in contrast with duress, where you feel compelled to agree, knowing that it's not what you want to do, or it's not in your interests, in cases of undue influence, your free will is overborne by that of another. The pith of this part of the majority decision commences at paragraph 30, and in accordance with earlier decisions, the circumstances in which this might arise is where undue influence might occur is in abuse of the court distinguishes and compares undue influence with unconscionable conduct and says they have distinct spheres of influence, but they do overlap. So both can arise in situations like abuse of confidence, misrepresentation, and pressure amounting to duress, but if not amounting to duress, then perhaps amounting to undue influence or perhaps to unconscionable conduct. The difference between the pressure which is brought to bear in cases of undue influence and those of duress is that, unlike in duress, or perhaps not, as the case may be in future, but certainly is now, in undue influence cases, there's no need for the pressure brought to bear to be illegitimate or illegal or improper. It simply has to be a pressure that is brought to bear upon you, which is sufficient to overbear your own free will. Now, the basis for the principle in equity is that where you cannot protect yourself, the court will step in and protect you. Now, where some pressure is, if you accept that some pressure is a characteristic of all relationships, then it's immediately apparent that the question of pressure in the context of undue influence will always be a question of degree. And that question of degree can be determined along a spectrum of your will being so completely overborne that you are, in effect, an automaton or a channel for the will of another, to, and this is the legal test, markedly substandard exercise of your own free will. And that, it may be observed, is what happened to Miss Thorne. Now, there are some presumptive categories where it will be presumed that undue influence exists. And those traditional categories are those of child and parent, child or guardian and parent, a religious, I think of it as a religious confessor, but a person in a religious relationship, or a doctor and patient. And there are, in addition to those presumptive categories, which are said to be not closed, but really in practice they are, in my submission. And it is at that point that the High Court very clearly and unequivocally rejected a submission by Ms. Thorne's representatives that being a fiancé, which was a traditional category of a presumptive relationship, is not, in the modern day and age, a relationship in which you could presume that one party, the husband, had dominance over another, the wife. So that is something which will be of no surprise to family law practitioners, but which has been clarified beyond any doubt by the High Court in this decision, and that's at paragraphs 35 and 36 of the decision. There are other categories of relationship in which undue influence can be established, and these are set out in the decision of Johnson and Buttress, but the characteristic attending upon those relationships is that there is a particular type of relationship of in which one party has ascendancy, one party is particularly dependent, or there is a relationship of trust between the parties. So these are the types of features to look for in relationships where it may be arguable that undue influence has been exercised in relation to the exercise of a party's free will. Now, the majority begins to deal with unconscionable conduct at paragraph 38 of its decision. The characteristic of unconscionable conduct is that there is a special disadvantage suffered by one party that seriously affects that party's ability to make a judgment in their own best interests. And that's the Amadio principle that Derek has already referred to. In circumstances where that disadvantage has been knowingly, including constructive knowledge, exploited to the advantage of another party, you may have a case where any agreement that's been given in those circumstances will not be enforced because it would be unconscionable to do so. In Amadio, the relationship, the special disadvantage was that the party wanting to set aside the agreement, which involved a transfer of property, was emotional dominance. So in that case, I think it was the wife emotionally dominated the husband. And that, I think, is of particular significance in the context of family law, where it's clear that emotion is high on the agenda. Now, in this case, the majority found that undue influence was established, and therefore that Ms. Thorne's consent to the financial agreement was vitiated. The majority found that Ms. Thorne's will had been subordinated, to use the language of the majority, to Mr. Kennedy's. And you'll be familiar with I'm assuming you're familiar with the facts, but perhaps I should just briefly recap on those. Mr. Kennedy was a wealthy property developer what was he worth, Derek? 18 to 24 million. He had three adult children, I believe. And he was of advanced age. What was he? 67. 31 years older than Ms. Thorne. They met online. She was originally from Eastern Europe and living in Dubai, I believe. They met online and he went and visited her and took her on a sort of whirlwind trip through Europe, and they spent, in fact, months travelling, I believe it was. Brought her back to Australia, showered her in the luxuries that he was able to extend to her, and in very short order, they were engaged to marry. Now, Mr. Kennedy, in the evidence was that Mr. Kennedy had always said that his money, in quotation marks, my money is for my children. So he'd always made it apparent that he wanted, and had always made it apparent that he wanted some kind of arrangement in relation to his wealth vis-a-vis Ms. Thorne. However, he said he wanted to marry her, she wanted to marry him, she wanted to have children, and in due course they were engaged and the wedding was arranged. It wasn't until some three weeks, I think, before the date of the wedding, that he actually gave her the documents that he wanted her to sign, and he arranged for her to see an independent solicitor whilst he waited outside. And the High Court found or agreed with the trial judge that the fact that he was waiting outside, the fact that the detail, although she knew generally that he wanted to some kind of arrangement, the fact that the detail was not known to her until such a short time before the wedding, after everything had been arranged, her family was already in Australia, and that's something that's a fact to which the High Court makes particular reference. The majority makes particular reference. All of that had occurred before he showed her the document that he wanted her to sign. All of these factors were reasons why the High Court found that her will was overborne. Only what he wanted. The ultimatum he gave her was that you either sign this in the terms that I've given it to you or the wedding is off. And in all of the circumstances, that was an overbearing of his will by her. The factors to which, and this is the paragraph you'll want to note above all others, the factors that the High Court has said are relevant to a finding or to the question of whether there has been undue influence over a party are firstly, whether the agreement was offered on a basis that was not subject to negotiation. Secondly, the emotional circumstances in which the agreement was entered, including any explicit or implicit threat to end a marriage or to end an engagement. Again, a particular point of relevance to family lawyers. Thirdly, whether there was any real time for careful reflection. And fourthly, the nature of the party's relationship. Fifthly, the relative financial positions of the party. And sixthly, the independent advice that was received, and whether there was time to reflect on the advice. Now, the High Court's finding in relation to undue influence is emphatic, but the majority did not stop there. They went on at beginning at paragraph 65 to talk about the unconscionable features of Mr. Thorne's conduct. And they mention in particular that Ms. Thorne's special disadvantage was known to Mr. Kennedy. Her special disadvantage had been in part created by him in the sense that he brought her to Australia, isolated her, got her family here. He created the urgency with which the prenuptial agreement was required to be signed and the haste surrounding the postnuptial agreement and the advice upon it. Now, the court does say at some point that if there had been more time given to Ms. Thorne to consider her position, that would be a key reason to perhaps find that there had not been undue influence or unconscionable conduct, but in all of the circumstances found by the trial judge in this case, both of those findings were open to the trial judge. Now, another thing that's noteworthy in the case, if you're going to use it as your sort of touchstone for these cases, is the court provides an evidentiary guide at paragraphs 41 to 43, where it sets out how the evidence of these relationships can be presented, which is quite useful. So in summary, duress and undue influence under section 90K1A is dealt with in this decision, and this decision is and will remain the leading authority until someone brings another duress case, which the High Court could determine. And 90K1E, unconscionable conduct is similarly covered. And for these reasons, these are the reasons why, in my view, this is an extremely useful case which you should be familiar with and have in your toolbox. So, thank you.
I anticipate that paragraph 60 of the decision, which is where the court, the majority, set out the factors, almost a checklist, that will become the sort of the most cited part of the decision. I anticipate there'll be the paragraph 60 factors and how they weigh in the balance. I'm going to look quickly at the two minority decisions, the decision of Justice Nettle and of Justice Gordon. each of whom found that there was unconscionable conduct but not undue influence. And in respect of Justice Nettle, was bitterly disappointed, and one can tell that from the veiled criticism in the decision as to the fact that duress was just wasn't pressed. The arguments on duress simply weren't advanced. And in fact, if you've read the transcript, it was quite an underwhelming outing, I would say. And I don't direct criticism of anyone, just that it just didn't seem to take off as one might have expected. Duress, let's remind ourselves with duress, from ANZ and Caran, from the Court of Appeal in this state and New South Wales, the analysis turns on the question of whether or not there has been unlawful pressure, that is, unlawful conduct that brings about the consent. In the first minority decision of Justice Nettle, His Honour, the Court says, I'm not sure that this is doctrinally valid to suggest that it would be confined to illegal pressure, and that there may be legitimate pressure that's brought to bear that would lead to a conclusion that there has been duress. I just note that there was a footnote to Edelman's Unjust Enrichment textbook. I think it was fairly widely anticipated that His Honour Justice Edelman would have a lot to say, and in fact might have gone out on a minority judgment in this matter, or may have taken the lead. In fact, His Honour held back, it seemed to me, a lot. There were very few questions from Justice Edelman at the hearing. The transcript does not have very many entries for Justice Edelman.
But he was quite excited. If you read the special leave transcript, he was quite excited.
So, His Honour's textbook, The Edelman and Pantin Just Enrichment, is footnoted extensively in the minority decisions. But Justice Nettle made the observation that if the High Court were now to depart from the jurisprudence as stated in Caron, that there would need to be a far more detailed argument and deep consideration of the ramifications of doing so, and that simply didn't happen in this case. And I think that thematically there was a sense of that as well from the majority decision. They had fully anticipated, I think, that would be a bit more to say, a bit more opportunity to visit this question of duress. So this will be a space to watch as to whether or not any other cases turn up in the next few years that may afford an opportunity for the High Court to visit this question of duress. Ultimately, the decision in Justice Nettle's determination was that the suggestion was rather that it would better accord with equitable principle if the test were to look at what's necessary for the protection of legitimate interests. Quite a different test as prevails under Caron. Ultimately determined that there was a taking unconscientious advantage by Mr. Kennedy of Miss Thorne's position of special disadvantage. Now let me read to you from the quote. In effect, it was a position of special disadvantage which he, the husband, created by bringing her, the wife, to this country. Keeping her here for many months in a state of belief that he would marry her, allowing preparations for the wedding to proceed, and only then, when she had ceased for all practical purposes to have any other option, subjecting her to the pressure of refusing to marry her unless she agreed to the terms of the first agreement. In all likelihood, things would have been different. I think this is an important point. In all likelihood, things would have been different if, instead of waiting until the 11th hour, thematically again, that was in the majority decision, instead of waiting until the 11th hour, Mr. Kennedy had made clear to Miss Thorne from the outset of their relationship that his love for her was in truth so conditional that the marriage he proposed would depend upon her giving up any semblance of her just entitlements in the event of a dissolution of their marriage. Now, at first instance, and on appeal to the appeal division of the family court, it was very heavily laboured, I think it's fair to say, that Mr. Kennedy had made it clear from the get-go, from the very outset, that his view was that his money was for his children, and he wanted a paper. So there was a making clear from the outset that there was going to be some plan in place, or some arrangements in place for his money to go to his children. I think it's correct to say that she was not aware, however, of the full extent of the wealth until later in the.
No, that's clear.
In the scheme of things, this is again reading from the decision, it can hardly be supposed that a young woman in Miss Thorne's position would be persuaded to abandon her life abroad and travel halfway around the world to bind herself to a sexagenarian if, at the outset of the relationship, she had been made aware of the enormity of the arrangement that was proposed. So that was a factor that played in the this minority decision's assessment of the existence of a special disadvantage. Although these are this is a minority decision, there are some useful pointers in here, of course, as to the signposts to what will be unconscionable conduct. And we hasten to add, as a chambers, of course, that the checklist in paragraph 60, which will be, as I say, I think a much referenced component of a part of this decision, really they are illustrative of the circumstances that might give rise on the one side to unconscionable conduct, and on the other side, undue influence. But those categories are not closed. It is not an exhaustive list. If we go then to the decision of Ron Justice Gordon, returned to the Amadio doctrine, that is the distinction between undue influence and unconscientious conduct, the quality of the consent versus the taking advantage of a special disadvantage. Her Honour was not satisfied that there was undue influence, but was satisfied that there was unconscionable conduct. Ultimately, Justice Gordon's analysis was to the effect, well, although the arrangement was one that was not necessarily to her advantage, she still did have free will. There was not that undue influence. The hallmarks were not there. She had the capacity to make an independent, I put it in there twice, but it's showing an independent, informed, and voluntary judgment about whether to marry Mr. Kennedy on his terms. So there was no undue influence. But she was unable in the circumstances to make a rational judgment to protect her own interests, and Mr. Kennedy took advantage of that special disadvantage, and that's what gave rise to the to her honest finding that there had been unconscientious conduct. Let me read to you very quickly from her honest decision, where she made the observation that the agreements were grossly improvident. And although it was not necessary or essential that there be an adequacy of consideration, it was relevant in Her Honour's analysis to observe that the entitlements that were provided under the binding financial agreements in the event of separation were extraordinarily and disproportionately small in comparison to Mr. Kennedy's wealth. And second, that the circumstances in which the agreements were entered into supported the conclusion that Mr. Kennedy's procurement or acceptance of her assent to each agreement was unconscientious. Now, let me read you one quote from here. However, having brought Miss Thorne to Australia, promising to look after her like a queen, it was not until 2 weeks before the wedding that Mr. Kennedy arranged for Miss Thorne to receive legal advice. And it was not until 10 days before the wedding that she received detailed information about his finances and became aware of the specific contents of the first agreement. It was in those circumstances that Her Honour was satisfied that there had been an unconscientious availing of the special disadvantage of Miss Thorne. So that's the minority. There were the two minority decisions. Ultimately, agreed that the financial agreements ought be set aside, and that the decision of the appeal division be overturned. But in each case got there via a different route to the majority circumstance. So where do we end up? It is a very, very useful decision in the context of financial agreements under the Family Law Act. There are some very, very useful guidance. There are some very useful signposts. And I dare say there will be checklists that will be developed off the back of the decision. But I think the mainstream commentary that it is the end of binding financial agreements, I think, is seriously misplaced. And I think that's the sentiment from this chambers. We are interested to know what you make of the decision, and we now throw open the floor to any suggestions or questions or commentary you may have. I think it's the ticking time bomb. I think it's the temporal element. I would say that. It was a migrant parents and a son and the bank.
Oh no, it wasn't a maid, a maidio then. It was the husband and wife, where the wife was dominating the husband. So that will be a matter of evidence. And it may, as practitioners, where you might get a sort of whiff that there's something not quite right, where you might want to make some inquiries, talk to some other people who have some insight into the relationship, as well as talking to your clients. Given that the court has said the emotional circumstances can
I mean, the cases do also make it clear that, you know, a sort of a raw bargain, absent all these other factors, is not in the realms of undue influence or unconscientious conduct. People enter deals all the time that, you know, that you know, may be a bit harsh and don't necessarily deliver what they want. So yes, people, when they enter into binding financial agreements, it's always going to benefit one party. Why else are they going to do it? But it's almost easy for us at the bar to stand here and, you know, make these observations. I think for solicitors, when you're at the, you know, you're the ones who are drafting it. I mean, I know from time to time I've heard the solicitors say at different times they have there's a line in the sand. If the wedding's in the next 3 months, they won't touch it. If the wedding's in the next whatever period of time.
I think that temporal means it's very clear.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
It is commonly the case that at one point someone will say to the other, this relationship will continue if this agreement is entered into. So that is not such an extreme element.
Yes.
That is an aspect of concern. Equally, it's a bit sort of harps to your anecdote earlier in terms of the money won't be that soon.
Yes. Yes.
So I think that is a concern. Whilst I thought the press coverage was quite hysterical at the time as well, that is an area of concern that ultimately.
But isn't the difficulty or an issue about that is if you have procured the commitment to the marriage and then deliver the ultimatum, that is what becomes problematic. If Mr. Kennedy and Ms. Thorne had in February of
I think you're right that it's not the most ideal vehicle because it was so heavily weighted on several on a couple of factors.
Although the full family court.
Well,
yes.
Although I do wonder if there will be some working out of this, one imagines, and yeah, I mean, you know, going back to that paragraph 60, whether the agreement was offered on a basis that it was not subject to negotiation, look, you either sign this or, you know, the relationship's off. We know that that's commonly said. Whether that factor in and of itself, I guess that's going to be, there may be, one can fairly anticipate there are going to be more cases that work out these sorts of dynamics. Sorry, Ed.
Well, an observation was that if you look back at Amadio and the guarantee cases around the same time on unconscionability, it led to wholesale changes of the way banks do business in relation to lending and guarantees with family members. And I guess my question flows on from a comment about timing is, what sorts of procedural changes would sensibly be brought in to manage these sorts of applications in the same way that banks did to deal with unconscionability and undue influence and those sorts of issues with guarantees? How do you manage this in a non-corporate arrangement? That's probably a difficult question, but it's so the banking industry dealt with it to deal with these decisions, and over 15 years they stopped having their mortgages set aside and then mum and dad lent money to the stupid son. In a sense, the question is, how do you manage the same problem in a family context?
It seems to me, in a practical sense, that you can't really allow the relationship to progress unless not just the fact of the need for an agreement, but the terms of the agreement are made clear at the outset. Because I think one thing that was new here, Kennedy, was that he'd said he'd look after her. So, yes, whilst he'd said there was going to be paper to be signed, he'd also said he'd look after her. And so she didn't understand that what that actually meant was he'd look after her dying, not separated. So, I don't know, but in a practical sense, we just require that only to advise people that well before a marriage date is set, that the terms of the agreement.
Yes.
One of the some of the feedback that we've had in relation to Kennedy and Dawn from solicitors is that often these agreements, if brought up, not, you know, too close to a wedding, that's the death knell of the relationship in any event. So your point about relationship, romance squared, I think is a really
the
primary one. In the context of such a large asset base, like why should you contribute
like
it to in a year's time?
And is there the flood of applications or the indications of floods of applications that the popular press are talking about?
Please join us for a drink.